Welcome back. So today we're going to be talking about finding maximum and minimum values of a function of multiple variables. And so by the end of the day, we're going to give the definition of a local maximum slash minimum of a multivariable function. We're going to want to be able to give the definition of a critical point of a multivariable function, and then we're going to want to be able to calculate those critical points for a multivariable function. And tomorrow we're going to get started talking about classifying critical points as maxes or mins, or potentially neither. And this is all going to follow a very similar route to how we talked about maximums and minimums back in Calculus 1. So, to begin with, suppose that we have a certain point called x0, y0. And when we plug it into the function, we get an output which is larger than all the outputs from the points surrounding our point. In other words, this output is greater than the function's value at any other point near where we are. If this is true, and the function's output is greater here than anywhere nearby, we say that x0, y0 is the location of a local maximum of f of x, y. And in this case, the actual output at this magical point, x0, y0, the output is called a local maximum value. Now, if I just simply go in and change the word greater to the word less, in this case, the output is smaller than the output of any nearby point. In this case, we call x0, y0 the location of a local minimum of the function. And in this case, the actual output is called a local minimum value. So let's have a look at this graph, which I've constructed using sine functions. It looks a little bit like a picnic blanket that has been raised and lowered at its checker marks. Each of these crests, at every single one, of these hills, each of these is higher than all the points nearby. Each blue X is the location of a local max. Now, meanwhile, at the bottom, of each of these little pockets, that point down there at the bottom of the pocket is lower than all of the surrounding points. So each pink X is the location of a local min. And it occurs to me right now that if you're not viewing the notes in inverted colors, this is going to be very confusing. So let me just make a note that this is blue and this is pink. Okay, now we do have a convention for local mins and maxes, which is exactly the same as it was back in Calculus 1, which is that if you have a point at the very edge of a function's domain, such as these points on the rim of the hemisphere in this drawing, those do not count as local maxes and they don't count as local mins. So even though these points on the rim of the hemisphere are lower than all neighboring points, these do not count as local minima because of this convention that they cannot be located on the very edge of a function's domain. And that's just an agreed upon convention. Now, a critical point of f of x, y. Let's just recall what critical point meant for a function of one variable. Critical point of f of x meant that f prime was equal to 0, or f prime was undefined. And in the two-variable situation, we're going to be replacing f prime equals 0 with the requirement that both of the partial derivatives are 0 or undefined. Now, we're going to express that condition using the gradient vector. A critical point of a function of the function f of x, y is a point where the gradient vector is equal to the zero vector, which is to say that f of x is equal to f sub y is equal to 0, both are 0, or perhaps the gradient vector is undefined. Maybe there is a sharp crease or corner in the graph that is causing one of your partial derivatives or both of your partial derivatives to be undefined. In that case, we say that we're looking at a critical point of the function. And now we encounter Fermat's theorem, which says that every local minimum and local maximum of a function of two variables is located at a critical point. So if you're looking to make a function's value as big as it possibly can be, or as small as it possibly can be, if you're trying to solve an optimization problem, we generally start by finding the gradient vector for the function, setting it equal to 0, and trying to locate any critical points, because those critical points are excellent candidates for local mins and local maxes. So to conclude today's topic, let us find the critical points of the function given here, f of xy is equal to x squared plus xy plus y squared plus y. So let's start by finding the gradient. Which will require us in turn to find both f sub x and f sub y. So f sub x, found by taking the derivative with respect to x using power rule, will be 2x from the first term, y from the second term, and both of the last two terms vanish because they have no x's in them. If I take the derivative with respect to y, x squared vanishes, xy becomes the term x, plus y squared becomes plus 2y, and plus y becomes plus 1. So we require two things. We require f of x equals 0, the first component of the gradient is 0, and we require that the second component is simultaneously 0. So let's set both of these partial derivatives equal to 0 and see what comes of doing that. Okay, so let me separate that with a line. And on the left-hand side, let's take 2x plus y equals 0. On its own, this implies that y must be equal to negative 2x. Now, if I look to the right-hand side and say that x plus 2y plus 1 must be 0, I can now use the fact that y must be equal to negative 2x. Now, we're really just doing method of substitution here to solve this system of equations. Say that based on that restriction, y must be negative 2x. Based on this restriction, x plus 2 times negative 2x plus 1 must be 0, which implies that negative 3x is equal to negative 1, and x is equal to 1/3. Now, based on that, if we use the fact that y must be equal to negative 2x, we can conclude that y must be equal to negative 2/3. And so we get a critical point, only one. Where x is 1/3 and y is -2/3. Okay, now I think it might be educational to stop for a moment and to go out to GeoGebra, have a look at the graph of this function and see if it matches, you know, what we have found here. Okay, so here is our function, which I have typed in with one equal sign and a plus. So now we can see that the function does indeed seem to have a local minimum around this value that we calculated, where the x-coordinate represented in red here is equal to about positive 1/3, right about here, and the y-coordinate is equal to -2/3, so right about here. That does match our calculation. Okay, so having seen that in full view, let's go ahead and do a few more exercises, and let's use graphs to figure out whether the critical points that we find give us local mins, local maxes, or neither. Okay, so here, for example, we have f of x equals x squared plus y squared. So f sub x would be 2x, f sub y would be 2y, and if both of them were to equal 0, this in turn implies that x and y must both be 0. So the only critical point that we have obtained is the point where x and y are both 0. Alright, so a graph of this object, the graph of this function is what's called a paraboloid. It looks like a parabola that's sort of been spun around to make it a bowl shape. And looking at the point 0, 0, it appears to be a local minimum for this function. So based on the graph, that's how I would classify this point. I would classify this as a local min. By graph. Now let's have a look at the point f of x equals the square root of 16 minus x squared minus y squared. Now let's go about finding f sub x and f sub y. Now f sub x can be found, must be found, using the chain rule, where we have an outer function formed by the square root and an inner function formed by the polynomial here. So the square root corresponding to a power of 1/2 gives me a power rule. 1/2 comes down, and 1/2 becomes a power of -1/2. And then we can take the derivative of the inner function with respect to x. And the inner function with respect to x will give us -2x. All right, now f sub y we can find in a very similar way. Use power rule to take the derivative of the outer function. Use chain rule to get the derivative of the inner function. And if both of these are to be 0, then their numerators must be 0. So once again, we're back to concluding that x must be 0 and y must be 0. Okay, now if we have a look at the graph of this, this is our very familiar hemisphere, so I will just go ahead and draw it on the side. This is our familiar hemisphere of radius 4. And so the point 0, 0, based on the graph, would correspond to a local maximum. All right, and in the final example, let's consider f of x equals x squared minus y squared. And let's go ahead and find f sub x and f sub y. If both of these are to be 0, once again, this implies that x and y must both be 0. So our only critical point is 0, 0 again. Now, this one is actually a very interesting graph. So let's go back out to GeoGebra and let's graph this function technologically. Okay, now I'll have a look at this shape. Here we have a decrease in the y direction, followed by an increase in the x direction, creating a shape which is a little bit like a horse saddle. Sometimes folks will look at this and they'll say it looks like a Pringle, if you're fond of Pringles. So I think the terminology, you know, Pringles have not been around that long compared to what we're doing now, but saddles have been around for a long, long time. So this 0.00, which was a critical point, but not a local min, not a local max, neither, this kind of point is called a saddle point. So let's go back to the notes. This one is not a local min or max, and this one is called a saddle point. Okay, so what we're going to be doing in the upcoming videos is we're going to develop some techniques similar to the second derivative test from Calc 1 that can be used to determine whether a critical point is a max, a min, or neither, even if you don't have access to the graph, even if you can't just graph it and see it, or if the graph is too complicated to understand. We'll talk about that tomorrow.